And as they do their lesson, we're going to talk about Mark chapter 2, especially talking about the calling of Levi. And beginning a new series, beginning something that I thought would follow the Easter good news very well, is this idea of sanctifying, this idea of always becoming more and more like Jesus Christ. And if you're like me, maybe you had the original idea, maybe you had the thought that life would be one easy path, one easy road. Maybe you thought that this Christianity thing would be something where I say yes, where I accept the promises of God, and everything becomes simple. But instead, what we begin to find out, what we begin to see, is that life is not an easy road. Life is not a straight line. In fact, very often, it's this messy line. And so you see that in the middle of your worship folder. You see, as we begin this title series called Messy, you see that this line is all over the place, and life can look very, very distraught at times. And as we talk about that, we begin to wonder, where is it that God is making his move then? Where is it that he is speaking to us? And as we talk about the word sanctifying, as we talk about becoming more and more like Jesus Christ, my hope is that you understand that this is a process, that this is a lifelong journey of becoming more and more like him. There will be days where you feel so close, and there will be days where you feel so far away. Recognizing all of that, I want to look at Mark chapter 2 to begin our series. Mark chapter 2, starting at verse 13, it's under the heading, The Calling of Levi. We have it pulled up there for you. You can also follow along on one of the Bibles from the back. You can follow along on your smartphone as well. Beginning at verse 13, this is the word of the Lord. Once again, Jesus went out beside the lake. A large crowd came to him, and he began to teach them. Now, I want to just pause for a second, and I want to talk a little bit. We're going to walk through the entire passage, but I want to talk a little bit about why it is important that we hear a large crowd coming to Jesus, that we hear a group of people seeking Jesus out. Now, pay attention to the fact that this has, at the beginning of Mark, kind of set the tone for how Jesus's ministry is going to go. In fact, we hear Mark say it's happening again. Once again, Jesus went out beside the lake, and once again, a large crowd began to follow him. Now, I want to just bend our minds for just a second and jump to verse 15. And so you see that on there as well, because we might be asking, well, who is it that's following him? Who is it that's chasing after him? Who is it that's making this large crowd? Who are the people that consist of this large crowd? And in verse 15, you see, skip over the first part because we'll talk about that more, but these are tax collectors and sinners who are eating with him and his disciples, for there were many who followed him. So think about the fact that these are tax collectors and sinners that are making up this group that is coming to see Jesus. This is the tax collectors and sinners who are making up that large crowd that began to follow him. And then jumping back to verse 13, we're still there, remember, he says this, Mark says this, Jesus began to teach them. Jesus began to teach them. And I didn't want to glance over this too quickly because I want you to recognize that it has happened before in those tax collectors and sinners' lives. It has happened before in our lives where we're actually told no. Where you try to follow someone, you try to sign up for something, and you're told no. You're told that you can't be a part of this group. You're cut from the team, whatever it is. All of those things are applying to these tax collectors and sinners because they have been told time and time again. They have been told no, that they can't join in. They have been told that they are outcast from society. They have been told no in so many different situations. But instead of that, Jesus begins teaching them. And that's not something that we can take lightly. In fact, I wanted to look at Matthew chapter 19 to jump to a different gospel. Because if you remember this story just a little bit, in Matthew chapter 19, we had disciples who were seeing the children come and bother, quote unquote, Jesus. Jesus was trying to do his teaching. Jesus was trying to explain things to all of the people. And these little children kept coming and tugging on Jesus' cloak and coming and wanting to sit with Jesus. And remember, the disciples were the one who actually say this. They say, no, these children can't be around him. These children can't be the one that are bothering him. These children need to be taken care of. But instead of rebuking them like the disciples, Jesus says, let the little children come to me and do not hinder them. For the kingdom of God belongs to such as these. And the reason I bring that up, the reason I jump to Matthew chapter 19 is because I imagine Jesus saying the exact same thing to the people when talking about tax collectors and sinners. I imagine Jesus saying this exact same thing, jump back to Mark chapter 2, when we hear these large crowds coming to them, when we hear all of these tax collectors and sinners coming around Jesus, it would have been very easy for the disciples, it would have been very easy for the Pharisees that we're going to see later to say, no, these people can't be around Jesus. Why are you spending time with them? And Jesus says those same words that he said about the children, don't hinder them. Let them come to me, because the kingdom of God belongs to people that are searching. The kingdom of God belongs to people that are humble. With all of that being said, we're on verse 14, Mark chapter 2. As Jesus walked along, he saw Levi, son of Alphaeus, sitting at the tax collector's booth. I want to just take a second to give you a couple historical thoughts about Levi. Now remember that Levi is probably the one historians will think that his name is actually changed by Jesus. He's given a biblical name, Matthew. And so he's actually thought to be one of the disciples. He's thought to be one of the people that has his life changed by Jesus. But before all of that happens, here he is sitting at a tax collector's booth. And I want you to pay special attention to the fact that Mark, who is actually writing to a group of Romans, most likely, Mark is writing to a group of people who are not familiar with the Israelite history, not familiar with what is going on. He's writing to this group, and he calls Levi the son of Alphaeus. And the reason that that becomes important is because, number one, Alphaeus must be a name that some people are going to recognize. Have you ever done this? It's almost silly to ask, and I think we've talked about it before, but I'm Gary, son of Bill and Nelva. You're so-and-so, son of so-and-so. That's called Dutch bingo, right? We've all played that game. You recognize that your tie to someone is who their parents are, who their grandparents are, who their brother and sister is. You recognize that you tie them together because of who their family is. And the same thing is happening here as Mark is introducing Levi. Don't forget, guys, he's saying, this is Levi, and you might remember Alphaeus. Oh, yeah, that's his son. And so now we're talking about someone we know. And why is that important? Because he is sitting at the tax collector's booth. Now, I spent some time thinking about this. I spent some time doing some research, and maybe you've heard this before, but maybe this is new. The understanding is that throughout the Gospels, quite often, tax collectors are looked down upon. Quite often you hear a word like this that says tax collectors and sinners. They're kind of lumped together with this group that no one wants to be a part of. And you might wonder, well, why are these tax collectors looked down on? Why are these tax collectors thought to be kind of outcasts from society? And there's all kinds of reason for this, and I wanted to give you just a little glimpse of the fact that the Roman government was controlling the Israelite people at that time. Remember, we studied all about the how Jesus was thrown under the Roman government and how the Israelites actually crucified Jesus by bringing him to the Roman government because they had to have the Roman government sign off on it. And so the Israelites, being under the rule of the Roman people, actually had to pay taxes to the Roman government. And of course, all of the Israelites, or most of the Israelites, were not very wealthy. They didn't have a lot of money. They didn't have a lot of finances. And so it was very hard for them to give the little that they had to the Roman government. And so the Roman government started to get a little bit creative about this. They would send people to the houses. They would send people to where the Israelites were living to take money from them. And sometimes that got a little violent. Sometimes that got a little hardcore because they would physically take money away from the Israelite people. But then they would find that these Israelite people would revolt against that, of course, because if you're having something taken from you physically, you're going to revolt a little bit. And so they got a little bit smarter about it. And what they began to do is say, okay, what we're going to do instead of sending one of our people in to take your money, we're going to take one of your people, the person that you know well, the person that is a family, a friend, all of that kind of stuff, and we're going to pay him to give us the money that he collects. And so recognize that an Israelite person who is being paid by the Roman government was supposed to go to his family, to his friend, and take the taxes for the Roman government. And hopefully you're tying some of this in your head. Our human nature is going to say, well, why on earth would I want to be around that person? How on earth could I not be upset at that person? This is my family. This is my brother, my sister, whoever it is. They're now taking money from me for these bad guys for the Roman government. How can I respect that person? How can I like that person? And so that's just a little bit of a history of why these tax collectors are lumped into this outcast group, because Levi is one of the people that the Roman government would have been paying to go to his friends and family and to take money and give it to the Roman government. And of course, the government would satisfy all of Levi's needs then. They would satisfy all of the tax collector's needs. And so the tax collector would be walking around with enough food, with enough clothes, with a nice enough house, looking at all of his friends and family who were being taxed until they were poor. Understanding then that this is why they were outcasts in that society. Even to the point of Levi sitting at the tax collector's booth, not being one who went and knocked on the door, but being one who would stand at the toll of every road and would say, hey, you have to pay me in order to get past this road. You've paid tolls before. You either went through the easy pass or you dropped the money into the slot. And if you're like me, you kind of think, well, this is silly. I was just driving. How about this? When we would go to New York, when we drive to New York, there's roads that don't cost anything. And then a road right next to it that costs money to drive on. And I don't understand, and I love the fact that on GPS you can actually set a setting that says avoid all of the tolls, because I am Dutch. And so understand something here, that it's silly to have to pay to be on a road. And that's what Levi is taking part in. That's what Levi is experiencing in this moment. He's sitting at the tax collector's booth, collecting money as people are walking down the road for the Roman government that the people actually hate. And so all of that being said, as Jesus was walking along, we're in verse 14 here still. As Jesus was walking along, he saw Levi, son of Alphaeus, sitting at the tax collector's booth. Follow me, Jesus told him. And Levi got up and followed him. Now, I want you to be reminded of something. I want you to be reminded of the fact that it wasn't too long ago that we had a series called Radical Obedience. And during that Radical Obedience series, we spent time looking at scriptures of people, at stories of Old Testament characters who would have heard a calling from God and simply said yes. They would have heard a calling from God from some sort of scenario and said yes to what God was asking them. So I pulled up a couple of reminders for us, a couple of them from Genesis, a couple of them from Jonah. If you remember Noah, we talked about the fact that Noah was asked to build an ark. And how silly would it be when there was no rain, when it was looking bright blue skies outside, he begins to build this huge boat. He begins to build this huge monstrosity of a thing that is supposedly going to save all of the people. Noah did everything just as God commanded him in Genesis chapter 6. And if you remember this, Abram. Abram, before he was Abraham, before God changed his name, Abram was called to leave his country and to go to a different place, to leave his country and to go to this place that God is calling him to go to. In Genesis 12, verse 4, we read, "So Abram went as the Lord told him, and he separated from Lot there." Abram was 75 years old when he set out from Haran. And then finally, we talked, if you remember, about Jonah. And quite often we associate Jonah with a reluctant prophet. We associate Jonah with being one who originally said no. But don't forget that he did actually say yes. Even though God had to kind of pull his teeth to get him to do it. Even though God had to send him into a big fish. Even though God had to do all of these things to get him convinced. Jonah ends up obeying the word of the Lord and going to Nineveh. Recognizing that Nineveh was a very large city, taking 3 days to go through it. We read that in Jonah 3, verse 3. And I just want to remind you that this "get up and followed Jesus" line in the New Testament, in Mark, is something that we are still called to do. Recognizing that we are still being called to get up and follow when Jesus asks us to change a life. When Jesus asks us to change our life. When Jesus asks us to do something different. Maybe, just maybe, part of what you need to hear this morning. Maybe, just maybe, what the Holy Spirit is tapping you on the shoulder with this morning is to knock it off. Whatever that thing is that continues to be in your life, stop. Get up and follow Jesus and go a different direction. Maybe, just maybe, you're being called to start something. If the Holy Spirit has been tapping you on the shoulder, hey, you need to begin this thing. You need to start this thing. Whatever it is that is in your mind right now, maybe, just maybe, this is God telling you, be like these Old Testament examples. Be like the New Testament example that we read about Levi. Be the one who gets up and follows. Be the one who gets up and goes and has that radical obedience. Before we get off of that passage, before we leave verse 14, I don't want to leave without saying there is a recognition here that this messy spirituality is not just a freedom to say, well, my life is like this, my life is not a straight line, so I can just do whatever I want. This is not a freedom to just say, oh, I can continue to live in a crazy way, I can continue to do things that are evil, I can continue to live in my sin. Understanding that when Levi gets up and leaves the tax collector booth, he is saying no to the Roman government. Understand that when he gets up and he leaves what he is doing, he is saying goodbye to the lifestyle of richness. He is saying goodbye to the lifestyle of power. He is saying goodbye to that old life. We're going to find out more about this as we go on through this series. But remember, Paul actually tells us that the old is gone and the new has come. And there's no room for us to do those old things anymore. This is what Jesus is calling us to. As sort of a reminder then, I wanted to fast forward to Luke chapter 19. And if you remember the story of Zacchaeus. Zacchaeus was a wee little man. A wee little man was he. And I won't break out into song for you, but the understanding is that Zacchaeus had much of the same calling as Levi. He had much of the same story as Levi. In fact, some historians will actually think maybe these are two stories that are kind of sort of the same story, but just told from a different angle. Understand that Zacchaeus was one who had been charging the people too much money. He was one that had been taking all of these things from his own people, from the people of the Israelites, and giving them not only to the Roman government, but really giving them to himself and promoting himself. And so when Jesus comes across Zacchaeus, you remember that he looked up because he saw him in the tree and he told him to stop what he is doing and come and follow Jesus. In this, in Luke chapter 19, we actually read Zacchaeus's retribution. We read his response to what Jesus asks him to do. Zacchaeus says that I am going to give half of my possessions to the poor. And if I've cheated anybody out of anything, I'm going to pay back four times the amount. The understanding there is that Zacchaeus was headed this way, and when Jesus came and found him, he did a 180-degree turn and went the other way. And the reason I point that out is because the same thing is happening with Levi. Even though we don't have the detail, even though we don't have exactly what it is that Levi said, we do know that he got up from the tax collector's booth and he followed Jesus. Just that is enough to know that Levi left his life, that he left the life of charging too much, that he left the life of being a tax collector, and he began to follow Jesus instead. So maybe, just maybe, what the Holy Spirit is tapping you on the shoulder with is it's time to do a 180-degree turn. Maybe, just maybe, the Holy Spirit is tapping you on the shoulder and saying, Jesus loves you so incredibly much that he loves you too much to leave you in that life of sin. He loves you too much to continue on in that path. He's calling you to do that 180-degree turn and to follow him instead of following the world. Maybe, just maybe, we are finding out that he loves us so incredibly much that he asks us to follow him out of our life of sin and to instead live for him. So we continue back on in chapter 2 of Mark, just the end of this story, so to speak. The last paragraph there, it says this: while Jesus was then having dinner at Levi's house. And so he went to Levi's house, the person that he just asked to follow him, to get up and follow him. Levi follows him, and then they go to his house. While he was having dinner at Levi's house, many tax collectors and sinners were eating with him and his disciples, for there were many who followed him. Understand that Jesus sitting down with this group is something intimate. Jesus sitting down with this tax collectors and sinners is something personal. Maybe you actually heard the promo for this story, for this series. And in that promo, I had Sandra tell the story of our first date. And if you remember what I said there, what Sandra said there, was that I was incredibly messy during our first date. And I began to use like 20 napkins or so. And I began to be pretty embarrassing. And she still continued to date me. So that's just a testament to the fact that God was pushing that through, right? The understanding being that when you sit down with someone, you're actually kind of vulnerable when you're eating. You're vulnerable because you're using your napkins. You're doing something personal. And I don't want you to lose the fact that we just celebrated it with communion. Remember, we celebrated the fact that getting your feet under the table with someone is incredibly important. And so let me do a little plug, of course, because we're doing the Linking Arms groups, right? We're doing one tonight. I just heard somebody say, yeah, I'm going to so-and-so's house and we're going to have this meal. Understand that that's a really important thing, to have a meal with someone, to connect with someone, to be that vulnerable with someone where you actually do this personal thing of eating together. This is what Jesus was doing. This is what he was doing when he sits with these tax collectors, when he sits with these sinners. Understand that this is something personal that Jesus is doing with them, and this is something personal that he wants to do with us. He wants to be that close to us. He wants to have that kind of relationship with us. He wants to be so incredibly close that he knows if we use 20 napkins when we eat. He wants to be so incredibly close that he knows if we use too much ketchup. He wants to be so incredibly close that he understands us, that he lives with us. And he's not a far-off God. He's not a God who created and left. He is a God who sent his son to walk here on this earth and to dine with tax collectors and sinners. He is a God who sends his Holy Spirit into us today to dine with sinners like us. Understand that this spirituality thing that we are trying to understand is not some far-off God, is not some far-off program. Instead, this is a personal thing. In chapter 1 of the Messy Spirituality book by Mike Iaconelli, there is a quote that goes something like this: spirituality is not a formula. It's not a test. Instead, spirituality is a relationship. The way of the spiritual life begins where we are now in the mess of our lives. Spirituality is about God being present in the mess of our unfixedness. And so somewhere in the middle of that line, wherever you are, wherever it was really good, wherever it was bad, instead of just being a perfect straight line, somewhere in the midst of that line, that is where Jesus is coming to meet you today. He wants to sit down with you. He wants to dine with you. He wants to fellowship with you. He wants to have a relationship with you, knowing that it's not about getting everything fixed and then presenting ourselves to him. It is about him meeting us where we are. Remember, I said it when we baptized Huxley. This is God making the first move. This is God coming to us to begin a relationship with us. The end of the passage actually says this in verse 16. Go back to Mark chapter 2. While Jesus was having dinner at Levi's house, many tax collectors, sinners were eating with him and his disciples, for there were many who followed him. In verse 16, when the teachers of the law, who were Pharisees, saw him eating with the sinners and the tax collectors, they asked his disciples, "Why on earth does he eat with tax collectors and with sinners?" On hearing this, Jesus said to them, "It's not the healthy who need a doctor, but the sick. I have not come to call the righteous, but I've come to call the sinners." I can't get out of my head in verse 16, when the teachers of the law, the Pharisees, saw him eating, they asked this question, "Why does he eat with tax collectors and with sinners?" That's not very far off from a question that we actually had at youth group a couple of weeks ago. At youth group, we were talking about justification. And if you know the word justification, it's the fact that Jesus Christ makes it just as if I had never sinned. Because of the lens of Jesus Christ, I am now seen as a spotless being through God's eyes. Because of what Jesus Christ has done, I am now worthy of being into this eternal life, of being accepted. And understand that all of this, this justification talk can very easily lead us to question, well, why? Why wouldn't he save this person? Or why would he save this person? And why wouldn't he do this? And why wouldn't he just save everyone? Why wouldn't everyone be free from this bondage of sin and hell? And as we begin to talk about that question, as we begin to ask that question, we had one student, and he wouldn't let me say his name, but he's running the sound, and his name sounds like Devin, Devin. And Devin said this incredible thing. He said, it's not a question about why wouldn't he save everyone. It's a question of why would he save me? At that point, I slammed the floor, and I said, "Devin, that's it. That's the question that we have to get to." Rather than say, why on earth would Jesus eat with tax collectors and sinners, instead of being those Pharisees standing outside the door saying, why on earth would he be around those dirty people? Why are we not saying, why on earth would he be around me? I'm a dirty sinner. I am the one who doesn't deserve him. And yet he gives me his grace, and yet he gives me that relationship. And so thanks be to God that we have the understanding in this passage to not be the one standing outside of that group and saying, how dare Jesus eat with those people? But instead we join in with that group because we are that group, knowing that we are the ones who need the doctor, knowing that our human nature makes it a messy life like this, knowing that we are the ones who need Jesus Christ. This church, a church, is not a hospital for the healthy. This church, our church, church in general, is for the sick. It's a hospital for the ones who need the good news of Jesus Christ. And we present that good news, and we say, and we live the fact that he loves us so incredibly much that we can't stay where we were. We can't stay where we were. We live a different life now. We turn around because of what Jesus Christ has done. On hearing this, Jesus said to them, "It's not the healthy who need a doctor, but it's the sick. I've come to call the righteous. I have not come to call the righteous. I've come to call sinners." I had a pastor friend, a mentor, who once suggested a book to me. And maybe I've told you this story before, but he said something along this. I said, I want you to read Pilgrim's Progress, and I want you to take note of the fact that it's not called Pilgrim's Perfection. It's called Pilgrim's Progress, knowing that as followers of Jesus Christ, knowing that as followers who are continually up and then down and good days and then bad days, we continue to search for Jesus Christ making a difference in our life, knowing that it's all part of the journey, knowing that it's all part of the progress. As we walk through this series, as we hopefully become closer and closer to Him, recognize that it's not us moving towards Him, it's Him moving towards us. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let's pray. God, because of You,